So, good morning.
Good morning.
Hosanna. Hosanna. We are alive. Have you noticed that? We are all alive. We're alive here. We're alive in our world. Let me tell you, let me share with you a couple reasons why I say that. Right now, even though we aren't fully reopened, you know, we're only open for worship, the building really virtually remains closed. Behind the scenes, there's a lot of things happening. I announced a couple of weeks ago that White Lake Presbyterian Church had become a member, or had become a Matthew 25 church. And I want to explain, we actually got our certificate for that. I need to get a frame. Let me explain a little bit more about that. So accepting the Matthew 25 invitation means that we committed to acting boldly and compassionately by embracing one or more of three areas of focus. One is building congregational vitality, another is dismantling structural racism, and the third is eradicating systemic poverty. And we have committed to becoming fully engaged in our world, in the world around us. And you'll hear much, much more about this in the days to come. Your faith formation team, which is the team formerly known as Christian Ed, is very hard at work finding a new woman's Bible study for us to begin our Tuesday kind of deal. And we're beginning a confirmation class this Wednesday following Easter. And there might be possibly six young people attending that confirmation class, which is wonderful. Your mission team has been very hard at work on things like getting snacks for the kids at Oxbow Elementary, which I will say as your reminder, if you haven't already, we would appreciate it. You can drop them off at the church if it's easier just to write a check. Make sure you write Oxbow on it and it will get to Michelle and where it needs to be. Members of the mission team have been very hard at work building, moving, and developing plans for our very own White Lake Presbyterian Church food pantry. This is such an exciting new program that we are all invited and encouraged to be a part of, and there'll be more on that coming as well. Your worship team has been very hard at work throughout, but especially during Lent, with special music from Marion this morning, special music from Bill, and of course, always beautiful music from Joy, and special services, which reminds me to tell you, don't forget that Monday, Thursday service is here at 7 o'clock this coming Thursday. It is a communion service, so we hope that you will join us. And then Good Friday, the church will be open between 1 and 3 for if you'd like to just come in and pray, just for a quiet reflection time. I'll be here if you want somebody to pray with. In your evangelism elder, Mark Maupin has been incredibly busy working with me on social media and YouTube ways for you people at home to share in our worship with us. Also to get a presence out there. We are very much a presence on 59. We need to be a very much a presence around the area as well. It's fun to watch this unfold. If you've not seen any of the stuff, our Help Wanted ad is out there. They did a little interview, a little press release out there about me, which was really fun, and it's just really a great thing. So that's Mark. We have visitors attending. We have people who haven't been with us in a while attending. People are excited to be a part of this family of faith-filled folks known as White Lake Presbyterian Church. And I'm so glad that you're all here with us today. I already mentioned about those services, but let's now talk COVID protocols, shall we? Because, you know, there's been a 116% increase in COVID cases in our area. And this worries me. This is one of those things that keeps me awake at night. This is why we tweaked our entrance this morning. why we ask you, and I'm so grateful that you are cooperating in where you're seated, why we ask and expect you to stay in your seats until the ushers release you following worship. All these things are the ways that we'll continue to be able to worship together. We've talked about moving back outside, perhaps next week for Easter. Stay tuned for that. We realize that a few of you are not comfortable with that, but we also realize that a great many of you are comfortable in the wide open spaces of outside. If you haven't tried it and you're sort of still against it, if you will, just give us 1 week try. You'll enjoy it. I think everybody would agree. Outside worship all last summer was wonderful. It was a wonderful thing to do. I want you to know that none of our decisions come without a great deal of prayer, discussion, debate, and thought. Please know that. I've said this before, I'll continue to say it. This is how it has to be. The minute we let down our guard and someone gets sick, you know what will happen. We will shut our doors again. And I know nobody wants that to happen. So, speaking of that, there's one little glitch in the system that has happened kind of week after week after week, and I need to address it. As soon as you are released by an usher this morning, it is imperative that you move right on out of here. You cannot stop in the aisleway and have a conversation because everyone behind you cannot get out. It is important that you move right out to the parking lot. I said parking lot conversation is beautiful. Sanctuary and narthex conversation is not. So do me a favor, on your way out, I was up all night baking. Just kidding, I really wasn't. There is a hot cross bun for each one of you on your way out the door. If you're missing a couple of people or whatever, help yourselves. So that's your little Easter. We're used to having breakfast this morning on Palm Sunday. So have breakfast to go. There you go. And I think that is all. All I need to say now to you is God is so good.
All the time. And
all the time.
God is good.
Let us come together in our time of worship. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethpage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, 'Why are you untying this colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And he rode along. People kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he now approached the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying,
'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven, glory in the highest heaven.'"
The peace of Christ be with each of you.
Also with you.
Amen. We have a beautiful offering this morning from Joy and Bill. There are words on the screen that in no way invites you to sing along. Please. This is meant for you to be able to read the words and listen to the song, because they're beautiful words. So.
No singing.
No singing.
This is to celebrate Jesus' entry into Jerusalem at the start of Holy Week and the Passion. And this is one of our favorite Easter songs.
Above all power,
Luke 22:39-62. He came out and went, and as with his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into this time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into this time of trial." While he was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, it is with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man." When those were around him saw what was coming, they asked, "Lord, should we strike them with the sword?" Then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this," and he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me, but this is your hour and the power of darkness." Then they seized him, led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following a distance, and when they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Pet sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, someone else seeing him, "You're also with them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." Then about an hour later, another kept insisting, "You surely were with him, for he is a Galilean." But Peter, "May I not know what you're talking about?" And at that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows tonight, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly.
Let us together confess our sins before God. Jesus, our Lord, we shout hosannas to praise you. With eager hands, we place our cloaks and palms on the path before you. Yet, Lord, we confess that the mouths that seek to praise you often deny or defy you. And we confess that the hands that seek to serve you often become this. Lord, hear us as we confess in silence. Friends, the Lord God helps us. We will not be disgraced. The Lord God helps us. Who can declare us guilty? Sisters and brothers, beyond the shadow of doubt, our sins are forgiven. By the mercy of Christ, let us stand together forgiven and free. Amen. So Palm Sunday, if you remember, is a Sunday filled with lots of scripture. So the very long scripture to read to you, listen for the word of God. This comes from the book of Luke as well, Luke 22. "Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking him, 'Prophesy, who is that that struck you?' They kept heaping many other insults upon him. When the day came, the assembly of the elder of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought him to their council. They said, 'If you are the Messiah, tell us.' He replied, 'If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God. All of them asked, "Are you then the Son of God?" And he said to them, "You say that I am." Then they said, "Without further testimony, what other further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips." Then the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying, "We found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king." Then Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered, "You say so." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no basis for an accusation against this man." But they were insistent and said, "He stirs up the people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where he began, even into this place." When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at the time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had been wanting to see him for a long time, because he had heard about him and was hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at some length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. Even Herod, with his soldiers, treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put on an elegant robe and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people. And here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." Then they all shouted out together, "Away with this fellow. Release Barabbas for us." This was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but kept shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." A third time he said to them, "Why, what evil has he done? I have found in him no grounds for a sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him." But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over as they wished. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid a cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming that they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they began to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this, then the wood is green. What will happen when it is dry?" This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray together. Come, Holy Spirit, source of all life. As we hear again the story of the Passion, let the same mind be in us that was in Christ, who was a servant that we might be free. Awaken our ears, open our hearts, and sustain the weary with your word. Amen. Well, so today usually we are focusing on palms and little kids and you know, parading in with them. The kids would wave them while we sang All Glory, Laud, and Honor, if you remember. And in they came. But this year, like last year, this one is completely a different Palm Sunday. Actually, last year was completely different. It was the Palm Sunday that wasn't, if you remember. In fact, all of this coming Holy Week will look a little bit different. We won't celebrate the Lord's Supper like we always do, where you come forward, instead having our own little individual to-go cups of communion. Everything just feels a little different, a little strange, doesn't it? But the truth is, that's okay. It's okay. Nothing about our lives is the same anymore, right? Nothing in our lives. The circumstances of our lives this year made this year especially important to remember and hold on to certain things. So is today still Palm Sunday, even without waving and processing with palms? You bet. It absolutely still is. Palm Sunday is still Palm Sunday. Actually, it's not even about palms, if you think about it. It never has been. It was instilled about Jesus entering Jerusalem. Today, we are all in Jerusalem. Think about this. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil. Funny. If you think about it, the whole world is in turmoil still today. It's in the air. It's in our hearts. America is in turmoil. Some days I feel like I'm in turmoil. I bet you can say the same. Today, we are all in Jerusalem. The whole city was in turmoil, asking, who is this? And they were told that it was the prophet, that it was Jesus of Nazareth. That's all they were told, just Jesus. But there's so much more. He was so much more. This is the one God sent to us because God so loved the world. This is the one who said, when two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among you. This is the one who said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. This is the one who said, do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. This is the one who says, I am the good shepherd. I am the light of the world. I am the resurrection and the life. This is the one who said, remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. I hope you hear the whispers of Easter in what I just told you, because I want you to do something. I want you to look around. Look at all that is happening in our world. I want you to look at what is happening in yourselves. Pay attention to all of it. Those moments when you feel stress, the moments when you start into someone who believes differently than you do. It'd be difficult, but remember, Holy Week is always difficult. Whether you come to service on Thursday night, which I sincerely hope you will, or you come and pray silently here in this room on Good Friday afternoon, listen for the echoes of Easter. Listen for the crowds as they shouted Hosanna. Listen for the tension of what was to come. Stay awake this week. Don't close your eyes. Don't turn away from your Holy Week, because this one who enters into the turmoil of Jerusalem, the one who comes in the name of the Lord, this is the one who will rise to a new life on the third day. And he has plans on taking you with him. 2 years ago, I read this to you during Palm Sunday service. I'm going to share it with you again this morning because it's such a powerful story. Here's a man who was born in an obscure village as a child of a peasant woman. He grew up in another obscure village. He worked in a carpenter shop until he was 30, and then for 3 years was a traveling preacher. He never wrote a book. He never held an office. He never owned a home. He never had a family. He never went to college. He never put his foot inside a big city. He never traveled 200 miles from the place he was born. He never did one of the things that accompanies greatness. He has no credentials but himself. He had nothing to do with this world except the naked power of his divine manhood. While still a young man, the tide of popular opinion turned against him. His friends ran away. One of them denied him. Others betrayed him. He was turned over to his enemies. He went through a mockery of a trial. He was nailed on a cross between two thieves. His executioners gambled for the only piece of property he had on earth while he was dying, and that was his coat. When he was dead, he was taken down and laid in a borrowed grave through the pity of a friend. 19-wide centuries have come and gone, and today he is the center of the human race and the leader of the column of progress. I am far within the mark when I say that all the armies that ever marched, and all the naves that were ever built, and all the parliaments that ever sat, and all the kings that ever reigned, put together, have not affected the life of man upon earth as powerfully as this one solitary life. Amen. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the others rebuked him, saying, "Do not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation. And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, while the sun's light faded and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." And when all the crowds who had gathered there for his spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the woman who had followed him from Galilee, stood in a distance watching these things. So now we have a little treat for you, some music from 2010 concert, or choir concert from 2010. Lift up your heads.
Thank you.
right there. I could hear Bill. I could hear Bill's voice. That was great. Thank you. Maybe we'll do that again, a couple of songs here and there. So now as we enter into our time of prayer together, I would like to ask if there's anyone that has any specific prayers this morning that we can pray for you besides Joy. Yeah, Peg.
Don. Our son Don. He had a stroke.
Oh, no.
He's okay.
Okay. Well, he had a stroke, so there's that. Yeah. Anyone else that... Dave.
Diane still has some time to limp around before.
Diane and her limping. Got it. Barb?
My sister Pat.
Oh, okay. Anyone else? Yeah.
Julie Johnson. Julie, yes. Cancer.
Okay, Julie and
Mo.
Mo? Okay. Okay, let us pray. Oh, sorry.
Shirley Brendel.
Who?
Shirley, did you say?
Oh, Shirley.
My friend B, Howard, her cancer has returned.
Okay, B, okay. Let's pray. Jesus suffered death and rose to glory for the life of the world. Let us lift up our hearts in thanks to God and pray for the cares of the world. Save us, O Lord, for your mercy is great. Holy God, your Son humbled himself even to death to show us the power of loving service. Guide those holding positions of power, that their decisions give rise to the mutual flourishing of the world you love so much. Healing God, your Son is betrayed and crucified in our violent world each day. Raise us to a new and rightly ordered world through the reconciling love of Christ, where all victims of violence, persecution, shame, or terror may stand together with you in peace. Forsaken God, as your Son suffered his cruel death on the cross, darkness covered the whole land. Enlighten us to care for your creation. Awake us from our denial and abuse, and help us to alleviate its suffering. Grieving God, your Son consoled others in life and in death. We pray for all who are distressed, broken, or sorrowful, that together with Christ in his suffering, we may be healed and raised to you. We pray for those needing your healing, for Steve, for Janet, for Ellen and Karen and Joanne. We pray for Diane. We pray for Joy and Pat and B. We pray for Don and Julie and Mo this morning, Lord. Eternal God, your Son was lovingly cared for as he was laid to rest in a tomb. We remember before you those who have died and pray for those who will die today. Enfold them in your love that they may rise and rest with Christ forever in his light. We ask all this in the name of Jesus, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, and who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Oh, poor Bill. Okay, so we're winging it this morning, and we get to hear Bill one more time this morning. How about that? But but I don't think that's what he's planned. I don't know what he's planning. Surprise. It's a surprise.
There's no singing over there. Until someone releases you. And don't, listen, we don't want 500 leftover hot cross buns, so help yourself on your way out the door, okay? They're really actually quite delicious, and I didn't make them. So let the same mind be in you that was in Jesus Christ. Go forth in peace and love and serve the world. And may the blessing of God, May the blessing of God who surmounts evil, who bears our pain and lives in us forever, fill you with a zeal for justice, a passion for peace, this day and forevermore. Amen. Have a wonderful week, everyone. See you Thursday, all of you.